My name is Amber Hammons. I'm an assistant professor in the Child, Family, and Consumer Sciences Department here at California State University, Fresno. And this week, we're talking about culturally relevant interventions. And I want to tell you about one specific type of culturally relevant intervention called Abriendo, Caminos. And this is a program that was designed by several of the researchers that you're likely familiar with by now, because you've probably heard them give their micro-lectures. It includes Drs. Angela Wiley, Margarita Turon-Garcia, and Barbara Feese. So Abriendo, Caminos focuses on Hispanic families. Why focus on Hispanics? Hispanics in the United States have an increased risk for obesity, type 2 diabetes, and coronary heart disease. Hispanics make up about 17% of the U.S. total population, and that makes them the largest ethnic or racial minority group. It's projected that by the year 2050, the Hispanic population will double, and it'll be about 106 million. There are many different subgroups of Hispanics. Some that have the largest numbers in the United States include Mexicans, Salvadorans, Guatemalans, Dominicans, Cubans, and Puerto Ricans. It's estimated that 39% of Latino children in the United States are overweight or obese, and that's relative to about 32% in the general population. Environmental factors that may contribute to overweight and obesity within the Hispanic population include affordability and accessibility to healthy food, access to green space, safe places to play, income level, literacy, cultural patterns, and life circumstances. So it's important to have culturally sensitive programs and educational programs that might help to decrease the burden of obesity in Hispanic families. Abriendo Caminos is guided by both socio-ecological and socio-cultural approaches. The goals of the program include increasing healthy eating as well as decreasing unhealthy eating. We took a particular focus on increasing fruit and vegetable consumption and reducing sugar-sweetened beverage intake. We also aim to increase physical activity, increase the quality of shared family mealtimes, as well as to prevent excess weight gain and or to maintain healthy weight. So we built on the existing strengths of Hispanic families, including cultural traditions, community connections, and the strong value placed on family. And given the importance of family, entire families, so including extended family members, were invited to participate in the workshops. So what did we do in the workshops? We had community health workers that were heavily embedded within the Hispanic population recruit families to participate. They also took part in helping to design the curriculum. We had university students that facilitated the workshops as well. The workshops lasted for 6 weeks, and families came in for once a week for a two-hour session each time, and these sessions were divided into three segments. We focused on nutrition, family meal times, and physical activity. Our materials, as well as the instruction, were research-based. Lessons included, they were about 5 to 10 minutes, and it was for each class. I'll talk a little bit more about our specific classes in a moment. All of our classes were delivered in Spanish, with the exception of the child class, and the child nutrition class was in both Spanish and English. At the end of the workshops, families were given health promotion materials. In the nutrition class, we focused on culturally relevant, affordable, and healthy foods. A couple of examples of some of the foods that we focused on: amaranth, cactus, and beans. This was the one class in which parents and children were separated, and this was just for half of the class. Content was similar, but in the child class, we had age-appropriate materials. We're focusing mainly on basic nutrition education, and it talks about having a balanced diet and eating, one of the examples, eating a rainbow of colors, having a rainbow of colors on your plate. This class was half an hour long, with parents and children joining back together after 15 minutes. In the adult class, we provided information for parents to make healthy food choices. Parents talked about cooking experiences and recipes. When children came back and joined the parents, we got parents and children involved in these hands-on demonstrations. We were trying to get active participation, active engagement in the material as much as possible. Did a lot of taste testing. So whole milk versus 2% versus 1% non-fat. We also had fresh versus frozen and canned fruits and vegetables. Can you tell the difference in different dishes? One of the classes, which the families turned into a game, is guessing the sugar content and different things like a candy bar, a can of soda versus 16 ounces of soda. What about, can you guess the amount of natural sugar in an apple? We also spent time making healthy snacks and healthy meals. The topics we covered included grains, proteins, fats and oils, portion sizes, fruits and vegetables, and beverages. So I want to say a little bit something about fruits and vegetables and beverages because this was an area that we really emphasized. Studies have found that Hispanic children consistently fall short of the recommended combined five fruits and vegetables per day. And parents have said that some of the reasons for why their children and why they might not be meeting that recommendation is because of perceived cost of fruits and vegetables, as well as the amount of time it takes to prepare healthy meals. And so we try to address these in the workshops. You can see here a handout. This is in English, but again, all of our materials were in Spanish. This handout has a lot of useful tips on it. So when fruits and vegetables are out of season, they can be really expensive to purchase fresh fruits and vegetables. So we talk about how frozen fruits and vegetables offer a similar nutritional profile as fresh, but they're much more affordable during that time. You can see also here that some other tips, exceptions to this, that some fruits and vegetables can be found year-round for around the same price. So bananas, pineapple, and apples as examples. Want to share with you the children's portion model. We had children getting involved in different types of activities, trying to bring these lessons to life. This was when we were talking about portion sizes. We also emphasized reducing sugary beverage intake. So sugary beverages are related to increased risk for type 2 diabetes and for obesity, related to just taking in excess calories, empty calories, displacing calories from healthier sources. And it's estimated that if children eliminated sugary beverages from their diet completely, that they could save on average 193 calories per day. And that's really big. Think about what that means over the course of a month or 6 months or a year. So for a child that drinks sugary beverages each day, this would be a huge savings. And we talk about replacing sugary beverages with water and ways to flavor it, perhaps adding a slice of cucumber, a slice of orange, lemon, raspberries, and strawberries. Research has found that the frequency of shared family meals is related to healthy eating and a lower odds of obesity. And in our family meals class, which is about a half hour long, the focus was on promoting the value of shared family meals. We also talked about preparing meals at home and eating them at home. Eating out is associated with more eating more calories, more unhealthy foods. We had a class devoted to discussing the organizational features of mealtimes, planning ahead, assigning roles of trying to get everybody involved in the mealtime. With younger children, perhaps setting the table, older children helping with food prep. We also had a class where we discussed reducing screen time, so turning off the television during meals, focusing on communication. This class included a component on scrapbooking, so families creating a scrapbook that represented who they are as a family, featured their family meals, as well as other family rituals. In the beginning of the workshops, families were given a set of conversation cards, and this was a conversation card for every night. And each week there was a specific theme. You can see a couple samples here. My personal favorite, describe your day with a color and explain why you picked it. Parents reported that the younger children really enjoyed this and just getting to hear what everybody had to say. We encouraged them to do this during dinner time. In our physical activity class, this was a class that lasted the longest. This was an hour long. We talked about strategies to incorporate physical activity in one's daily life. Each class included a 5 to 10 minute lesson that was followed by a warm up, then an activity, and stretching and a cool down. Here are some objectives for one of the classes that happened at the very beginning. So getting families to understand the impact of physical activity on their health, learning exercises to promote physical health, and understanding how exercise benefits health. And so we'd start with this lesson, and then the activity might be Mexican folk dancing or Zumba. We had another class that we focused just solely on walking, and it talked about how easy it is to walk as a family. It's free to do. If you're really busy during the week, you're busy during the day, this is an opportunity to catch up with one another while exercising. We gave, in the very beginning of the workshops, families received pedometers and encouraged them to exercise outside of the workshops. Many of the families said that they turned this into a fun challenge. It was a competition where they were seeing who could complete the most steps by the end of the program. We also had some fun homework assignments for the children. This is an example here. You can see this chart of just trying to track your activity throughout the day in 15-minute increments so as to help you to meet the recommended 60 minutes a day. We also had daily fitness challenges, and these were every day for the 6 weeks. An example of one of them was hula hooping at home and turning this into a competition, see who can hula hoop for the longest. The program ended with a fiesta in which every family brought in their favorite dish that they had modified in some way based on the strategies that they had learned in the nutrition classes. So they shared with the class what it was that they changed, and everybody exchanged recipes as well as sampled each other's dishes. This is one of the favorite classes. A lot of delicious food was brought in. It was also an opportunity for the scrapbooks to be displayed and for everybody to check those out before they were taken home. So was the study effective? And I want to share with you a little bit about our nutrition findings in the study. In our study, we had 75 families of Latin American descent, and they had at least one child between the ages of 6 to 13. This was done in the Midwest, and families were from rural communities. They're mostly Mexican origin, first generation immigrants. We used a pre-post test design where families received questionnaires in the very beginning before the workshop started, asking about their dietary behavior. So parents filled that out for themselves as well as for the children. Immediately at the end of the program, they filled out the same questionnaire, and then we had a 2-month follow-up in which they did not receive the program, the intervention anymore, but we wanted to see, are these effects sustained? And the program was associated with an increase in fruit and vegetable consumption, as well as a reduction in sugar sweetened beverage intake for children. And what was really positive was that we found that the sugary beverages intake actually even further was reduced at that 2-month follow-up. So extremely positive there. We think that the program was effective in part due to using bilingual and bicultural facilitators. We had literacy-appropriate materials and instruction in Spanish, these family-based activities, and social support. So families interacted with one another before the session started, during the sessions, and then after the sessions. Many reported that they built strong relationships as a result of the program, and we believe that that was important in helping the program to be successful. Today I wanted to share with you an example of a culturally relevant intervention. And Abriendo, Caminos was a pilot project in which one of our goals was to test the effectiveness of the program in producing behavior change. The next step is to do this study on a larger scale, to do a randomized controlled trial, and ultimately to refine the curriculum so that we can disseminate it freely to Hispanic communities across the nation that might be interested in implementing this program regularly within the communities.